Greetings and salutations, Seldon here. This lecture will be about the fork, which is a type of attack. And it borrows from a chess concept of the fork as well, where with one piece, you're attacking several units. And in chess, for example, if you're attacking several units with one piece, often only one of them can get away, right? The way it works here in Axis and Allies is if you're able to threaten two territories with units in one territory, you're forking those two, and you're often forcing them to retreat from one of the territories. A couple of ways it often works, and it seems to happen most often with the Axis powers. What I'm doing here is I've got just a bit of a got this pretty strong, and I've only got I could try and smash it with this. I've got, I don't know, about 30 or so units here. I could smash it with that, but it's only a 40% chance of victory or something along those lines. So, and it's just going to keep building up and up and up, and I don't have a good amount of infantry backing because I've just been trying to stop the British from dropping a fleet, which we're only round three, and they still haven't dropped a fleet in round three, so doing well so far. I'm only doing that with bombers and things like that, but it does mean I'm there for a little week. So so it leaves me in this position of I can just keep sitting here and this will keep getting stronger, and he's doing the right thing by holding West Russia as strong as he can. How do we get around that? So what I've done is I've forked West Russia and Russia. And I'm going to come in here with everything, and it'll be a little bit too strong for him to hit back at that. He's only got about a 20-something percent chance of hitting back, provided that this one Russian unit doesn't hit one of my forces. Then he's got a 30 or 35% chance. So if I move my forces in here, that one territory, units in that one territory are threatening those two territories, and he's really got to surrender. He's got to pull all his units back to Russia, really. It's the only thing, it's the only move that he has to make. The fork is seen in a couple of other places too. Once he's moved out to Russia, obviously I'll take West Russia, and then you get a second fork between Caucasus and Russia, and obviously he's going to pull his forces out, and he's got to defend, obviously got to defend Russia, and by that time I should have enough to hold West Russia, perhaps with some Japanese forces, and then basically once you've taken Caucasus, it's really hard for the Allies to come back from that. So that's what we're going to try and do. let's do the battle. Oh, wrong battle. But I also just, you got to keep the front lines as back as far as possible as well. Don't let them come too far forward. So we just keep pushing as far as we can. So if we can take an enemy unit strong, or any enemy territory strong, we take it. If we can't take it strong, we at least can't take it lightly, which is what I'm doing here. So I'm going to take Ukraine lightly. There are times when you can't even take it lightly. He's got too many units in there, in which case we just see if we can hold our ground. If we can't hold our ground, then we retreat. We don't just sit there and let the units get destroyed. So here's the one I wanted to show you. So I'm coming to Archangel. And just hoping that he doesn't get any units in, gets in response. And he doesn't. So he's only got about 20% chance of doing it. He's sort of forced now to retreat back to Russia. So I'll show you just what that looks like. If I put all these in here, he's sort of forced to go there. And the other beautiful thing about it is that if I put these guys up here, he could kamikaze these British fighters against them. He had five. I'll do the numbers on that. But if you see here, I'm here, just a medium stack in Belarusia. too. If he hits Belarus strong, he won't have enough to come back to Russia. So I don't think he can do it. So I think we're okay with that. And do I want to move my forces? Yes, I probably do. I'm going to move this guy back because these guys look like they're going to be coming up. let's get up here. We're basically just throwing everything we can at Russia. If you see here, he might take this. I'm just seeing if I can hold him off there. This is a little risky. I've got just 5 fighters there. But there's not much I can do about that because I want to be able to, with those fighters in Finland, you can actually threaten. You're actually defending all of these shipbuilding zones, fleet drop zones, but you're also able to attack Russia and West Russia and Caucasus, but you can only do it from Finland. I wanted to do it. The risk is that he can do 3 fighters, he could kamikaze all these fighters against it, but then again, you know, he'd be really, yeah, it's not so good. Tell you what I'll do. Gonna send this anti-aircraft back there. That makes it really bad from a numbers perspective for him, IPC perspective. So we're gonna do that. And this is still a 30-something percent chance of victory. And I might probably land a send this Japanese fighter on there as well. So what'll happen next? He sort of guaranteed he might do a strafe. I'm hoping he doesn't do a strafe on that. This is the big risk for me. He might strafe this or try and just knock it out. But he's really got to be surrendering or moving all his forces back here to defend against this. Make sure we get all those tanks in there. And then I can take West Russia. Forking again. I'm forking Russia and Caucasus, which means he's got to pull out of Caucasus. By that stage, these 4 troops will be here. I take and I'm holding then. And this is the actual objective. It's the Caucasus to hold that. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. You also see the fork very often from a Japanese perspective here too. So Japan will come up as strong and come up with a big force here in Kazakh. And that forks also Caucasus and Russia, meaning that the Russian troops have to surrender, have to retreat back to Moscow because you're threatening 2 units with troops in 1 unit, so you get a double, you get almost like a double bonus from those troops that are threatening 2 with 1. You do see it with aircraft and things as well too, like with a bomber can often threaten a whole bunch of stuff. Just in 1 territory, he can be threatening a whole bunch of different territories. So that's one of the strengths of bombers and aircraft and tanks as well. You want to try and maximize. If you've got a bomber that's threatening 4 or 5 different units, he's really, really earning his keep there. He's forcing him to move or retreat or bolster up forces in a whole range of, in a whole list of different territories, which is ideal. Okay, so anyway, that's the strategy of the fork. Surprising how many people don't do it. They just keep building up forces here, here, and here, and and you'll say yes, but Russia's going to now take this. Yeah, but they can only really capture it lightly anyway, and I'll just come in and smash them again next turn. That's fine. Okay, there's the fork. It's another little tool for your arsenal, and just great little tool to use. West Russia next, and this is what. So this is how we do it. We get a good force up in West Russia. If they try and which is the right strategy of holding here and big force of Germans in Karelia. If they try and hold it in West Russia and go here, this dislodges them back to here. Then you can move into West Russia. This dislodges them from Caucasus. You go in here, and then it's pretty much game over for Russia. Okay. Excellent. Seldon signing off.